Yeah, so the second talk is by Fabian Haiden, also here, and he's talking about categorical Kahler geometry.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much to the organizers for letting me talk here, giving two back-to-back lectures, so you get... I'll be talking a lot about different talks by me before here, but it's sort of going to be how they are or related part, kind of how they're connected. So yeah, I should start by saying this is all a joint project, ongoing, with a usual group of people, which is Tarkov, and Pundit. It's like an ongoing circle of ideas that we're trying to spin off projects. So the question I want to talk about today is kind of how some kind of notion of Kahler geometry in a categorical or non-commutative setting. So where do these ideas come from? Kind of what goes into the blender? So some hints about non-commutative. Categorical Kahler geometry. I'm not going to give a definition of what this should be, but I'm going to give some aspects of what this should be about. And I think something, I mean, if we eventually have such a theory, it would be why it would be useful and what it should include. So where is this coming from? So one is kind of representation theory, geometric invariant theory, or quiver representations, or representations of algebras. and here, so there's a Kahler metric. So you construct some modulized spaces of stable representation, and here the Kahler metric is coming from some symplectic reduction, Kahler quotient. So on this space of stable representation, let's say have some path algebra, some quiver, some associated algebra here, just given to you as a quiver of relations. And so one thing I'm going to discuss here is that this Kahler metric of modulized spaces, it doesn't just magically appear if you look at this. You need to make some choices to get this Kahler metric and talk about kind of what kind of input data you have. So this was started by Alistair King, investigation into representation theory. Kind of the second strand is Foucault categories, and it's more closely related to homological mirror symmetry. Right, and here's the analog of a stable representation. There's going to be some special Lagrangians. And again, they have a kind of Kahler metric on them, which, so the Foucault category itself sort of only depends on a symplectic manifold. Technically, you need to choose some almost complex structure, but it doesn't really affect the category in an essential way. But sort of if you have additional geometry, then you get some Kahler metric on the space of these guys, given by some sort of flux. Which is given by a closed one form with some direction f, some Hamiltonian perturbation, will be an integral f times omega. So if this looks a little bit cryptic, I'll go more into detail what this means. Omega here is a holomorphic one form. F is a Hamiltonian perturbation in this integrate over Lagrangian. This will give some.
Do you need Bragg connection?
So yeah, if you want this to be a complex manifold, then we need to talk about unitary connections also. At this point, it's just a potential on the space of special Lagrangian. It's not a Kähler potential. Yeah, I should say if this should be a. Yeah, so if this one, they want to be complex vector spaces. But so the reason why I'm being ambiguous here is because you can also, the way that the Kaya category is usually defined, you have not unitary local systems, but these things over the Novikov ring. And then this is a sort of non-Archimedean metric. Yeah, so here is kind of both. This goes a little bit into the non-Archimedean territory. Archimedean. If you have unitary bundles and non-Archimedean variables. And another input where it now becomes, which sort of tells you what kind of a notion of what a Kähler class could be for a category, which is stability conditions. So originally, this comes from kind of axiomatizing stability of deep rings due to Douglas. And then completion, make the axioms work. Was Frigilant, who looked at this paper and came up with the theory of the stability conditions. I want to think of this sort of as being a Kähler class on a triangulated or Vici category. I'll remind you of the definition later, but basically the central charge, which you can think of, integral, right? But it doesn't know about the geometry. There's no, the data doesn't include any kilometric or moduli spaces, but it just tells you that you have some space of stable objects. Kind of also maybe mention here, non-cumulative gauge theory, so some gamma of instantons on non-cumulative R4, which was this was investigated by Krasov and Schwartz and many other works followed, but sort of the idea that you have non-cumulative space and something like a kilometric. And you can talk about moduli spaces of instantons and they get amazing. So the question is sort of, is there some theory which will kind of unify this? So kind of how the question is here, how to bring these strands together. Maybe, depending, or as a mathematical question, that doesn't make a lot of sense, right? You just say, well, can I find a connection between this and that? What kind of by thinking about this, I think we've sort of discovered some sort of interesting aspect at least at this point. So there has been some kind of payoff about thinking of all these questions. Maybe not answering the original question, but sort of other. Discovering other things by making these connections. What I want to start with is the most concrete here, which is equivalent representations. That's easiest to explain. So
and second and fourth, Yamil's instant are not
So it's an ADHM construction where instead of the original R4, you deform it. The moduli space of non-commutative instantons will be deformation of the original one. So some desingularization. In the case of QR representations where you can make things the most precise and work everything out that you want to know. So just basic reminder, so Q some quiver with Q0 vertices, arrows, directed multigraph. And what's a representation? Complex numbers. Well, so this language of quivers is sort of a way of unifying a bunch of linear algebra problems, systematically studying them. So we're going to have vector spaces, VI, so it's some finite dimensional vector space. And then for each vertex, so each of the vertices, you sort of realize this quiver in the category of vector spaces in linear maps. So the alpha, for alpha is an arrow from I to j. Okay. And yeah, so this kind of stuff forms a category, usual morphisms. Okay, some Fi. Vi, some Wi, and they should commute with these maps D alpha. Say T alpha. A is J T S alpha. So you get commutative squares. Okay, and so the problem here is if this is a very simple quiver, you can just understand it very concretely, write down, classify these things, but sort of in general, you want to use some kind of geometry, so analyze this. Sort of space of these guys, and that means so you have a there's some global quotient stack of these representations, so it's going to be like a vector space, which is product over all arrows, right? So just kind of all the possible, we're fixing the vector spaces Vi, and we look at all the possible T alpha. So that's the product of Hom spaces Pi to Pj. But then we want to identify two representations if they're isomorphic. So if there's these Fi, these intertwiner maps. So it means taking some quotient by a group. So here I'm going to understand it as a quotient stack by a product over all the symmetries of these Vi, Pl. Right, so the question is basically to understand this geometric object. Well, but I mean, how geometric it really is, it depends on the stack, not Hausdorff. So it's not like a usual manifold or a variety. So the first thing, or if you want to study this kind of thing, is classical invariant theory. Look at this is just a vector space. You look at the polynomials which are invariant under this group of symmetry. classical invariant theory. Which is about finding some group action, you want to find the invariant polynomials. So that's how you call this some name. This is using group G and space X. G invariant. Right, which is going to give you, well, these will form some algebra, and it's some affine variety, and this affine variety is some approximation to this stack. So, and in this case, what are the points of that affine variety are going to be what's called a semi-simple representation. Points, well, the C points are the semi-simple representations. Semi-simple means the direct sum of simple representations. Simple means it doesn't have any non-trivial sub-representation. So kind of this first approximation of understanding this is semi-simple. Right, but there's going to be a lot of representations typically which are not semi-simple. So maybe just to give an example here, right? Something that everybody knows. If Q is vertex one loop, then a point in here is going to be a vector space, the action of some operator T. Semi-simple means just that T is diagonalizable. And the invariant functions are going to be just this generated by this algebra here. It's going to be generated by the symmetric polynomials in eigenvalues of T. Functions generated by symmetric polynomials in eigenvalues. Right, so it doesn't see the non-diagonalizable T. Right, so this example is maybe slightly misleading in that, right, this here is very situation, you just have one-dimensional simple representation. You can classify everything, and it's just a nice, you have complete classification of all points. But you know, even if you do something, you add an extra loop, now it becomes sort of a much more complicated problem. You have simple representation, arbitrarily high dimension. So this is some kind of some wild classification. General enough, but it's going to be sort of not as simple as this linear algebra.
Sorry, in the formation of this quotient stack, are Vi and Vj fixed vector spaces?
You could just, for each dimension vector, but only the dimension of Vi and Vj here matters.
Okay.
And mm-hmm. For every possible list of dimensions, I get one of these. I mean, I could take their disjoint union. Yeah, so here the Vi are dimension fixed.
Wild classification of the T1 and T2.
Yeah, so you have a vector space into endomorphisms. Right. So this means you have arbitrarily high dimensional families of simple representations. But what I want to say, so there's another criterion, sort of what semi-simplicity is, which is more geometric. kind of, in principle, if you have some representation, how do you check it's semi-simple? You would need to look at all possible subspaces. See, there's no, like every one of them has a complement in different subspaces. How do you see that, how do you prove that a representation is actually semi-simple? And it turns out there's another sort of a way to give a certificate of a representation being semi-simple in the form of a harmonic metric, so just a relation to check. So another interpretation of semi-simplicity. And so what was it? Now we need to assume that all these VI have some inner product or Hermitian spaces. And the idea is that we have this big vector space and there's a group acting on it, this group G. And the idea is, so there's going to be a bunch of orbits, right? And these orbits are basically points in our stack. And the idea is pick out some special points in each orbit. And how? In what sense are they special? Well, you put some norm in this vector space, or rather norm squared, so you put some function s from this x, so this was the product of alpha I v j. And so that map is given. It's essentially the norm squared on that vector space. It's how do you put a norm here? It's phase g alpha star g alpha. This is the standard inner product on a home space. So kind of this collection of g alpha get mapped to. So you can think of this in two ways. Either it's a function of g alpha, or it's a function of the metric, right? Because if I put a star here, it depends on what metric I chose on the vector spaces. So this here is alpha squared. Right? This function, it's not an invariant. This is invariant under the maximal compact subgroup. U product the unitary groups. But I could look at each orbit and I could try to minimize this function, right? So think about something like maybe this is our vector space and our group action is hyperbolic action. And then in each orbit, we're trying to find a point which is closest to the origin. So these guys here are orbits. They try to minimize because it could very well be that some orbit doesn't have a minimum. Like this positive real line here, something like this. If this is the orbit, doesn't include the origin, you're not going to be minimizing the norm. And the kind of miracle here, which is the Kempness theorem, tells you that you can do this minimization exactly for the semi-simple representations. So minimize S on given orbit. It's kind of the foundational theorem of geometric invariant theory. It's now a special case. So if I have some F representation. So this is semi-simple. If and only if. This function S has a minimum on this orbit, including this representation. And this is if and only if there exists a metric So you can look at it. You know, what does it mean for there to be a critical point of S? You can write down this condition. It exists a metric on the PI such that, write this here, the sum of commutators T alpha star T alpha equal to 0. And you can think of this in this kind of term here in several ways. Either you think of this as the gradient of S, right? And that minimum means being at a critical point of S, so it should vanish. Or we think of it as the a moment map for the action of this group U. Or maybe times I, this thing would be the moment map. Right, so U acts by some quantumorphisms on my vector space, so there'll be some moment map by this term. Right, and so one, you start thinking about how to prove this theorem if you want to use your time here productively. So one direction is pretty clear. If you have a metric which satisfies this, then you can just show that, you know, if you take an invariant subspace, take its orthogonal complement will also be an invariant subspace. So that's how you get semi-simplicity. But in the other direction, right, you sort of want to show that in this more tricky direction, you want to show that something is semi-simple, then there exists some metric or which this relation holds. And there the idea would be, right, to flow towards this minimum of S. And you just want to see if it's not, if the flow doesn't converge, if you don't go towards the minimum, then it's going to be, your metric is going to shrink on some subspace, and that will define an invariant subspace that contradicts this simplicity. So, I mean, maybe another way to think of this result is, yeah, the proof here, this is application of the Kempf-Ness theorem. Kempf-Ness theorem that the GIT quotient, which is semi-simple representations in this case, is the same as symplectic reduction, setting the moment map to zero and multing out by U action. Yeah, so maybe another way to think about this is that kind of an identification of two kinds of representations. So semi-simple set of semi-simple representation of this algebra. Algebra of the quiver gets identified with some kind of unitary representation of a star algebra. So, right, because we have some, our representation now has a metric, so kind of Hermitian representation of star algebra means, well, we form this algebra B, you take the double quiver, so Q bar here is the double, where there's an arrow alpha, then you add the kind of an arrow going in the other direction, the alpha star. So you introduce the quiver and its opposite, glue them together, mod out by this relation here. By the moment map. Right, and this theorem tells you that these two things are the same. And so this is a star algebra, it probably should be completed to a C star algebra. So here, I'm not an expert on C-star algebras, so, but the kind of picture, the idea of what is this C-star algebra also the left-hand side depends only on the algebra, but this depends on some kind of choices I make, because I'm representing my algebra in terms of some quiver, so I'm choosing bases, choosing arrows, so it means choosing the generators of my algebra. So this a priori depends on some choices, but tells us that these are more Ricci equivalent in a sense. Right, and should sort of compare this to an algebraic geometry. This is maybe X is some affine variety. And, well, A is algebra functions on it. And here B is, well, this C algebra is something like the topological space, locally compact. Of points of this variety. Take the C points, take continuous functions on that, and give me some C style algebra, which is commutative. So here I have a non commutative analog of this situation. By the way, at any point, if you have any questions, feel free to interrupt me.
This is all finite dimensional unitary representations, right?
Yeah, actually, in some cases, you can use this to prove. This is a good question. In some cases, you can prove there should be some infinite dimensional representation as well by continuity arguments. So definitely there's an interesting story here about the infinite dimensional representation. I don't really have a good understanding of it. So I'm just going to look at the finite dimensional ones. But geometrically, it's like looking at compact Lagrangian versus looking at Lagrangian foveations.
So in this analogy, what is the analog of the moment equations?
The analog of what?
The moment.
This is something non-commutative, right? Because I mean, it's sort of this whole expression doesn't have any analog in the commutative setting. I mean, this is in some way how you form the. So you can do this purely algebraically. That you take a quiver and you take the kind of opposite double quiver, and you introduce this relation, and it's again, the non-commutative geometry. It's some kind of construction which takes you to the cotangent bundle. Look at your original redshift. So the representation of this thing here will be something like, I mean, don't look at SARS, but look at all representation of this thing. It will be naturally like a cotangent bundle to your original space. So, I mean, that probably didn't answer your question. I'm not sure how that's.
Maybe that's a trigger.
In some sense. So the Kahler metric here, this situation, so these two sets are kind of the same, and they're also, they get a Kahler metric. So here it calls M. So there's a Kahler metric on M. Which is, I mean, it comes from abstractly, just the fact that you have it's a quotient. I mean, the original vector space, just so this thing, right? We're taking a quotient of this by this unitary group, symplectic reduction, symplectic quotient. And it's a Kahler manifold, the Hermitian vector space. There's kind of general theory that tells you that the quotient will also have a metric, but I mean, more concretely, it's given by this potential, so it's some I V bar. S, so this function S here is non squared, it's what gives you the Kahler potential on this space. The general reason why this is Kahler is symplectic reduction. The manifold. Well, just Hermitian vector space.
And the Taylor structure depends on the Hermitian structure put on the eyes, right?
That's true. I mean, kind of not really a choice of. They will all be sort of the same. I mean, there's only one Hermitian structure on each vector space. But I mean, it also depends on, I need to write my path algebra. Yeah, you're right. I mean, I need to choose, for each dimension vector, I need to choose actual concrete vector spaces. But I mean, more than that, right, I'm writing my algebra here. Maybe there's some relations, so, but. Even if it's just the path algebra of a quiver, there's many ways of writing it. Algebra has some automorphisms which are not automorphisms of quiver. So there's definitely some choices involved in writing down what the metric is. And actually, you can do something a bit more general. General class of Kahler metrics instead of just taking this norm squared. So, variant, a little bit generalization of this, which is sort of, it's going in this direction of trying to answer, you know, what, you want to have something like a Kahler metric on your associative algebra A, and what kind of data is that? And so here's an example. We choose functions for each error alpha, choose some f alpha from non-negative reals to reals, and it satisfies some conditions. So f alpha prime at 0 should be positive, and f alpha second derivative non-negative. Write down, kind of modify this definition of S. You can take S to be some similar like before, but here you apply F to this positive or non-negative Hermitian operator T alpha star T alpha. Right, so this is non-negative Hermitian guy, so it makes sense to apply some function F, which is defined on non-negative reals. And you can take trace. And so here the statement here is that
your alpha is different from your alpha, right?
Alpha.
Alpha. Oh, alpha is alpha.
Ah, sorry, there's an alpha here, yeah. Oh. Yeah. Thanks. So why do you want to put these conditions? What's the statement here is that this still gives you is a strictly pure subharmonic. So it gives you a Kahler metric. Kahler metric. Right, so invariant under U. And kind of in general, you could try to build more complicated, so some kind of formal expression in the completion of your algebra B. Right, so this is. Essentially comes from taking some expression in B and plugging in your T alpha as concrete operators and then doing a trace.
So the O1 is not a special case of this. F equal to 1 is not satisfying.
Well, F equal to X is It's a special case, yeah.
But that was not the old one. The old example is
so before we had F alpha is equal to X. Right, yeah. And it satisfies these conditions. So it's a little bit generalization.
So the F alpha should be outside the trace?
No, so like if F alpha is a polynomial, then this is a non-negative Hermitian operator. So in principle, we can take any measurable function and it makes sense. So this works kind of just as well, but I mean, it's clear here that this is not the most general ansatz for S that you can make. So the question here is, what's the most general form? S. So, I mean, in the sense that it should come from some certain element in this B completed. Right, which would sort of, since this would give you some sort of answer as to what is a kilometric on this algebra. Something that induces a kilometric on all moduli spaces. So there's a kind of, variant of the story, which is really what King did. So the reason that you want this is not too useful in some cases. For example, if Q is acyclic, has no cycles, has a quiver, then there's like every semi-simple representation will be just all these T alpha equal to zero. So all these spaces are zero-dimensional. You can deform this original situation, deform both sides here and this equal by introducing something, by considering stability. So the idea that you still want to study representation theory of quivers like this geometrically, then the approach of King is introduce something called theta stability. So you have to replace semi-simple modules by something, and involves a choice of some real numbers, beta I and vertex, and so these define some theta of the representation will be the dot product of this theta and its dimension vector. It is a map from K-theory, or from set of dimension vectors to real numbers. And so a representation is theta stable. It doesn't have any, first of all, theta of V is equal to 0. And then for any sub-representation, this theta will be positive. W is more trivial inside V. Then theta of W is positive. right? So if theta is just zero, then this is exactly being simple. So yeah, and then there's a notion of polystable. So just kind of like going from simple to semi-simple. Theta polystable just means a direct sum of stable things.
So theta can be positive negative, right?
Yeah, this doesn't have just real numbers. Yeah. Right. In particular, it could be all zero, and then it's just reduces to this theorem we had before. So the kind of generalization of this correspondence before is that some representation is theta polystable. If and only if there's kind of a variant of this equation, so it exists a metric. It's again a condition. We have a harmonic metric Hi on Vi such that one term is the same as before, the sum of commutators. It's the moment map, but now you're not setting the moment map to zero, but to this diagonal matrix of this theta I times projection to Vi. Again, it just means taking the fiber of the moment map at a different point. Right, so and this is sort of now, the proof is based on not classical invariant theory, but geometric invariant theory. So conceptually, what are these theta? These theta are some kind of polarization of my moduli stack. So think of them as a, if the theta are integers, then they define a line bundle on my stack. In general, it's a virtual line bundle. Theta I define. The virtual character of G, which sends a collection of Pi. Determinant Pi theta I, right? So theta are integers is really makes sense of equivariant line bundle. And they're real numbers, this is kind of virtual line bundle. On this stack, right? It's just a vector space, so line bundle here is just character of G. And then geometric invariant theory in general is a kind of machinery that if you make this choice, it gives you some set of stable points. And in this case, it's these polystable representations. So, theorem, again, think of it as a special case.
If theta is completely zero, then everything is stable, right? Theta is stable.
Stable, that means simple.
Right? So everything is stable.
If theta is zero, then
everything is
nothing is going to be positive. So this condition can only be satisfied if there's no W, which are, so if there's no non-trivial submorphisms of V. Because it's bigger. Right, but everything would be semi-stable. So, so this is kind of a special case of, again, something, maybe the Kempf-Ness theorem of this equivalence between GIT quotient and symplectic reduction. Right, so the stress of theta on one hand tells you which polarization, and on the other side it tells you which fiber of the moment matter you should take. So, here we have some product here. So this is what King did, and it allows you sort of to have a more general way of studying representation theory questions geometrically. But it doesn't yet have anything. It's a classical. There's no derived categories yet. So let's try to see how that works. And for quivers, there is something called the Bernstein category. Or we can look at chain complexes of representation, get some derived category. And then what is this about? These tell you that you have two quivers. They may not have the same representations, but they have the same. After you stabilize things, they have the same. So you have some pictures. You have some sink in your quiver. So all arrows pointing towards that. And then you can get quiver Q. And then you can get a new quiver by reversing, reflecting all these arrows that go into this, so making it into a source. So this gives you some other quiver Q prime. And there's a functor, it's also sometimes called mutation of quivers. There's a functor which takes representations of one quiver to representations of another quiver, which looks something like some V0, spaces V1, Vn. Right, I'm just drawing sort of, the quiver could be bigger, but I'm just drawing this piece of the quiver where actually the action is going on. So maps V1, Vn. Some part of a representation of this guy, and then a functor that sends it to. So here you put a kernel. So you only change one of your vector spaces at that one vertex where you're mutating. And you put the kernel of the map, just going from the direct sum of the vi to v0, which is given by kind of the row vector t1. And kind of combine all these maps, give you something, and you take the kernel. So that's the vector space you put at this newly created source. And then these maps here are just projections to the various summons here. So V1, this is projection. So you don't change these other vector spaces, they all remain the same, you just change them. This one vector space and the maps going into and out of it. So here's two at the end, and this is projection two again. And you can take this picture and sort of dualize everything inside, turn around the direction of all arrows, and make kernels, co-kernels, and projections, inclusions, and so on. And then you get the kind of other starting source, how you go to the sink. So the quiver, we get back the original quiver, but these functors are actually not. I'm going to say that. So these functors are not equivalences of categories. They take some subcategory and identify another. So for some representation, you can go back and forth, but not all representations. So there's also a dual variant here.
This is reflected in terms of the path algebra. You don't make a reference to vertices,
you kind of need to have a quiver, I guess, to make sense. The vertices make sense, there's some idempotents in your path algebra, right? And, there's a general framework. If you have some abelian category, you can forget about the path algebra, you can take some abelian category and have a torsion pair in that, right? Slice it into two pieces. So everything is an extension of one of the two. And then this is kind of a special case of all that, right? If you have a heart of a T structure in a triangulated category, and you have a torsion pair in that T structure, you can mutate it. And it means this is the abelian category. You take one end, and you kind of stick it, shift it, slice your abelian category into two pieces, and then stick it on the other side. And then instead of this, you have this. And that's how these categories are related. But for our purposes, interesting here is that this induces a equivalence of derived categories. So this functor is not an equivalence of abelian categories. Derived categories. Take your category of representation, pass to complex S essentially. So I mean the derived functor of this will be this derived equivalence. And sort of why do they care about these reflections? They actually allow you to take a very simple representation of one quiver and sort of doing this step a lot of times, you get more and more complicated representation, higher dimensions and so on, right? As you can already see here, right, if each of these vector spaces was one dimensional, well, but this is some kernel here, so it's going to be immediately a bigger vector space, so you can construct higher and higher dimensional representations. That was the original motivation for this. But here, so again, it's equivalence of DV representation of one quiver, DV representation of another, which is this mutated quiver induced by this vector. And so how does this relate to the Kahler metrics that I want to talk about? So what's interesting here, so what's surprising to us is that this actually preserves the Kahler metric we get on the moduli spaces. So theorem. So reflection, right, defines kind of map from one moduli space to another, and this will be an isometry of the reflection functors. So that's some kind of hint that maybe there's some, it works well with derived geometry.
I mean, for example, what if you apply this to the moduli space of representation of dimension vector 1 out of its node?
I mean, that's just a single point, right? Or
yeah, so it, I mean, but this functor will just kill that moduli space.
I mean, it's a suitable range, so you're right, it killed some representation. So this is not. Take a piece of this moduli space. But I mean, most representations will not be killed by.
Okay, so you.
So the only ones that get killed are the ones which are really concentrated on.
Remove all simple sum ends at that node.
If you do something like that, yeah. I mean, the exact way to say this again is you have these torsion pairs. So you have some. There's actually some subcategories of these two abelian categories which are mapped isomorphically by this and. So they're to be on that level, that's much. But kind of, yeah, I mean, in general, it's kind of very few representations which give light. So,
torsion pair is killed, right? Mutation kills the torsion.
Yeah, I mean, you have a torsion pair, and one piece of this pair is just all representations which are which are concentrated at that one vertex, and these get killed. Right, and the theta, so this works on, this works kind of for theta stability, but the theta need to be chosen compatibly on Q and Q prime. So there's some theta prime on Q prime, such that, so these should induce the same map from K0 of this category. The theta and theta prime induce the same K0 under this identification to real numbers. That essentially means you take the original theta and you kind of flip sign at that one vertex, and then you add this theta to the other vertices, V0. Something like that.
It's like a frog and curve in
Calabria. Is that what, sorry?
Frog and curve in Calabria.
Yeah, this would also be an example of a torsion pair for you, mutating a T structure, yeah. Okay, so what I want to say here is, yeah, so there's, but there's also, so right now you see that it kind of works a bit with E2 categories, and there's already kind of a theory of how to do stability, not just the theta stability, how to do stability for triangulated and DG categories, which are, so there's a kind of axiomatic of stability in triangulated DG categories. I mentioned at the beginning, it is Richland. And so what does this look like? So the data is that you have, this is called central charge, the two pieces. Sorry, central charge. That's what you see. One of these, let's say, triangulated. And so you have the central charge, which is going from, should usually factor through some finite rank lattice. Here, this is some fixed finite rank abelian group. Think of this as
map.
And the second piece of data is you sort of axiomatically, so unlike what I told you before with theta stability or some condition, you could test to say if something is stable or not. And here it's just given to you kind of a priori. So you have some additive subcategories. For each real number, so C phi C. Yeah, so this is called the central charge, and these are semi-stable of some phase phi. Objects of phase phi. And this has to satisfy now a bunch of axioms. Kind of reason why I'm going from this definition is kind of telling you what it doesn't contain. That's sort of what we are interested in. axioms are, first of all, there's a compatibility between this. So phi should be essentially the argument of central charge. E is non-zero in this case phi. Then central charge is a positive multiple of E, the I phi. Then one thing tells you sort of it's compatible with the shift functor. It takes C phi shifted by 1, and C phi plus pi. And phi 1 is less than phi 2. Then, and EI, you see, should be no morphisms, opposite direction from bigger phase to smaller phase. From E2 to E1 should be 0. Get 5 total axioms, more than 50% now. Then, the more interesting ones, so there's something called the support property. Some norm. Space and some positive constant. There's going to be a lower bound on norm of, so if I take any semi-stable object E, then this class, and you can think of this like a numerical class, this gamma should be bounded by C times absolute value central charge. And the final property, which is maybe the most kind of significant one to check, so these are not too bad yet, but because this only says something about the E is same still. This only concerns the semi-stable object, is a condition on all objects of the category. It says we can construct them all out of semi-stable ones, so if E is any object in C, then there is some tower of triangles, kind of cones. E0, E1, EN minus 1, EN. And there are some extensions by A1, EN. E, and these A1, so this means, right, this means taking repeated extension, doing extension by A1, A2, A3, and so on, until you get E, and we want that these AN are semi-stable, AI, AK, it's semi-stable, some phase phi K, and phases should be strictly decreasing. One strictly, so maybe non-zero. I want bigger than phi 2, bigger than phi n. Alright, so this is sometimes called Hadamard-Lassiemann filtration. And tells us how we build, take any object, we can build it. So this is unique. There's going to be a unique way how to build it out of semi-stable ones. And so, but these are just some kind of abstract axiomatics. It's not so what's kind of going on here geometrically. And this is where it gets a bit conjectural. At least if you want to one complete generality. So kind of, where does this come from? I mean, this actually originally comes from physics, from 2.2 theories, ability of deep brains. but it can kind of give a symplectic geometry interpretation of this stuff. Which is, well, conjectural for now, except in the lowest dimension. So we'll start with some Calabial X homomorphic one omega reflective form. So let's say it's compact. So Y, this is holomorphic N form, non vanishing. This is my symplectic form. Not assuming that the metric is reflective. Do not assume that omega to the n is omega. Right, so there's some kind of flexibility of how you choose your metric. And in this case, for Bayesian stability, we need some triangulated category. In this case, it's the Kaya category. It's an infinity category. Kaya category X. That's a symplectic form. And this is defined over the numerical field. Convergence. I mean, if you want to find it over complex numbers, some series which are not clear if they converge. So just use formal power series. Canonical field over complex numbers. Take real powers of T, and your exponents, if you have some, write down some power series, your exponent should go to infinity. Yeah, so this does not depend on, only depends on the symplectic geometry, not this complex geometry. Omega. And so there's now a conjecturally, you should get a stability condition on this category. So we need these two pieces of data, which I've already erased. Central charge is given essentially by right, so Foucault category, I mean, I'm not going to define here what it is, but some Lagrangian submanifolds in your symplectic manifold, and there's some kind of extra data to make sense of the category. But the first zeroth order approximation is just going to be a compact Lagrangian. And central charge of that should be just the period of omega, integrate omega by L. And the, this gamma is the middle homology of the manifold. And the stable objects should be roughly special Lagrangians in omega. Stable objects, so it's C5, will be special Lagrangians of phase 5. It means that the condition is that the argument, if I restrict my homomorphic N form to the Lagrangian, I can make sense to take its argument. And it should be constant equal to 5. Right, and here, strictly speaking, I need to choose some branch of argument over L. And that's part of the data of being an object in this category is to have this choice of argument continuously over all of L. Okay, so.
Is that clear that there's no hop between U2 and U1?
Yeah, kind of for great, the degree of the Homs can be computed by looking at the difference of phases. And so this condition here is clear. At least this one is easy to show. So this condition here is a bit tough. I mean, how do you, right? So I mean, this is, again, very approximate. Special Lagrangians, at least in higher dimensions, they probably need to be singular. And you know, they need to have this extra data to be objects in the Foucault categories. And it's called a bounding co-chain. It's a molar Cartan equation. You get for L and some solution to that equation, which may or may not exist. And the idea of why this Haranasiman property is supposed to hold is that how do you go from an arbitrary object, maybe arbitrary Lagrangian, which doesn't need to be special, how do you go to something which is built out of special Lagrangians? You take the kind of minimizing flow, mean curvature flow. A more precise, I'm giving a very rough approximation here of the conjecture, more precise. There's some work by Joyce who gives a bit more details on how to make that precise. Pre-print out. Well, and at least, you know, there's one case which is relatively easy to prove. This is just a surface, real two-dimensional. And then we write the compact Calabial. Well, it's not that interesting, it's just elliptic curve. You can allow non-contact stuff. Surface, this omega is an abelian differential, and then in this case you can actually verify that this conjecture is true. So here in this case, special Lagrangian just leads. It's the same as this being geodesic to the metric by absolute value of omega. By metric, they remove singularities. And you take the finite length. So just some saddle connections and closed loops and these kinds of guys. That's it. And you can show me. Well, I showed in my thesis, and you can prove that you get a stability condition on this category. But of course, it's not many analytical difficulties or anything. Q6. And so it's probably very difficult in higher dimensions. There's still a long way to prove this, as far as I know. But I want to sort of say what's kind of not, what this axiomatics of triangulate category and stability conditions sort of forgetting about is all the geometry you have in this case. It forgets, so not part of stability data, is, well, first of all, we have some. For each object in our category, we have an actual space of Lagrangians which can represent that same object. So, some object E. Lagrangians, which would be Hamiltonian isotopic. Which represent E. And this you can think of as an analog of putting a metric on your representation. So this is some metrization. And I'll see more why this should be considered as a metrization of E. It's kind of the analog of if you have a quiver representation that you have, you can choose a metric on it. That's kind of first piece, and then also we have somehow if we have such a space, there's a mass function, which in this case taking the volume of L, the absolute value of your holomorphic N form becomes a top form on your Lagrangian, it's kind of volume. Then we have a flow which is trying to decrease this mass. It's deforming L by the Hamiltonian function, which is minus d argument. So argument d argument of omega restricted to L. And so well, a small thing to check here, so opposition. So mass decreases under this flow. And then there's some kind of Kahler potential, I shouldn't say Kahler, but at least some function SC from metrizations from some object to complex numbers. This guy, which I wrote down before, so given to us by its exterior derivative in some direction, Hamiltonian deformation F of L. Would be integral L times omega. And the right, so this is complex valued. If we make it real valued, if we take critical points, real EI phi times SC are the special Lagrangian.
So E is the space of the Lagrangian representing
E is just some object, metrization.
So E is the Lagrangian.
Yeah, and this is Hamiltonian deformation of that Lagrangian.
So I'll just have the token equivalent class.
Well, I mean. In a way, yeah, it's a bit more complicated than I'm giving here some kind of first approximation of the true story, because there can be Lagrangians which represent the same object, but they're not going to be Hamiltonian isotopic. Kind of first approximation, changing the tangent space to what metrizations on an object should be is will be Hamiltonian deformation. Okay, so the critical points of this complex value contention are this, yeah. Maybe I'll continue after the break. So, yeah, any questions?
So, do you have some analog of a Baldemore Biesecker inequality in the Lagrangian case?
It's kind of support property that I wrote down.
That's the Baldemore Biesecker property.
So if you on the B side, right, you can construct stability condition, or I mean, there's a conjectural way of constructing that on the or DB code. And the issue is to prove this support property, or rather to prove that your semi-stable guys will not have class zero,
right,
and that this is this generalized, what they call generalized holomorphic disagreement.
So, but I mean, is there some interesting inequality in the Kahler side? Can you?
I mean, here it's kind of trivial inequality, right? It was something like norm of class of L less than equal to. I mean, not trivial, but C times central touch. Right, so it means. And if you take the period map, it means you get some discrete subset of complex numbers. Take your, and so this would be absolute value integral. And the claim is sort of, if you take these classes of semi-stable objects, special quantum lattice, then and you map them using your central charge, you form the discrete subset.
So, I mean, is this obviously true, or it's...
Yeah, it took a little bit of work. I think it falls from some Hodge theory, but yeah, it's really... I mean, this is some arbitrary norm here. So if this works for some norm on, so this norm is something on gamma tensor R, and right, if this is true for some choice of norm, then it's going to be true for all choices of norm because they're all equivalent. Right, but it's not, to ask when is it the same, this depends on what norm you actually chose on your lattice. Did that answer your question?
Well, can you just, I mean, do you have like a standard gamma, let's say just a cohomology, right, of the Kahler, and then you just use the, like, in that order?
Yes. So yeah, you can take a standard norm.
Yeah. Choose that, and you suppose that it's best contrast.
Yeah, I'm not sure. When this is. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay, perhaps let's continue after the break.